The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 12565 in the name of George Adam on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau on changes to the business programme. Any member who wishes to speak against the motion should press their request to speak button now. And I call on George Adam to move the motion.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And moved.
Thank you, Minister. I call Stephen Kerr.
Presiding Officer, knowing that the Bureau meets at 12 noon on the Tuesday to consider these motions, I'm rising at this point not to contest the business motion as much as to ask for something to be included at the earliest possible convenience. This morning it was announced by INEOS that their ethanol plant at Grangemouth is going to close at the end of quarter one next year. Now, this is an additional announcement on top of the previous announcements that have been made about the closure of the Grangemouth oil refinery, which would be scheduled to close by the end of quarter two 2025. Now, this announcement just this morning probably wasn't on anyone's radar when the Bureau met, but I'm rising to ask for a ministerial statement, an opportunity for the government to come to the chamber, because obviously people in Grangemouth and in the Falkirk area will be worried that this news comes on top of the previous announcement. And people will want to know, obviously, about jobs. They'll also want to know what the implication is for the wider industrial complex at Grangemouth, which is integral to Scotland's economy, but also to our plans for net zero. And then the other dimension of this, of course, is the flood prevention scheme, which is going to depend on resources coming not just from the public sector, from the private sector. This is one less business operating on that estate. So I think there are questions to be asked about the future role of Grangemouth in the context of this further closure. And so I'm asking, really, the Minister for Parliamentary Business indirectly whether or not there's an opportunity for this matter to be raised on the floor of this chamber at some point in the next few days.
Call the Minister for Parliamentary Business.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I understand the seriousness of the situation and how this would be something that people would want to discuss. But as Mr Kerr will be aware, there is a process within the Parliament, within the Bureau, to work through, and I would advise Mr Kerr, as I would any member who would make a similar request, to speak to his business manager and feed into the Parliamentary Bureau through that way. As Mr Kerr knows from his past involvement as the former Chief Whip, I'm only too happy to deal with any requests made by other members and see what we can do in the future.
Thank you. And the question is that motion 12565 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed. The next item of business is topical questions. And at question number one, I call Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported cyber attack on NHS Dumfries and Galloway.
Cabinet Secretary Neil Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I thank Colin Smith for raising this question. Colleagues, I wish to outline at the outset, will appreciate that this incident is the subject of a live police investigation. As a result, I'm limited in the detail that I can share. However, I want to assure Colin Smith and other colleagues that the Scottish Government continues to fully support NHS Dumfries and Galloway as they respond to the cyber attack. While I understand this news will have been both alarming for patients and staff, I can assure Parliament that the Board responded swiftly and in line with established protocol. I have personally spoken to the Chief Executive of NHS Dumfries and Galloway, and I'm assured that my officials are fully supporting them as part of a multi-agency approach. And in addition to this, I can advise that other NHS boards, at the Government's request, have been mobilised to provide technical support to Dumfries and Galloway.
Colin Smith.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Well, so far there does appear to have been no major disruption to patient services caused by these attacks, which is welcome. It is deeply worrying that there is a risk that hackers were able to acquire a significant amount of information, and this could include patient and staff identifiable data. We know from past attacks on the NHS that the motive can often be related to extortion attempts on organisations or individuals. So can the Cabinet Secretary tell us what actions are being taken to protect staff and patients from any extortion attempts? And will he give a clear assurance that there will be clear open and transparent communication with staff and patients over the possibility that they could find themselves approached by someone claiming to be in possession of data relating to them, so they know what to do in such circumstances. People are worried, Cabinet Secretary, yet communication so far has been very limited.
Cabinet Secretary.
First of all, the NHS Dumfries and Galloway made public the situation last week, and advised people that should they have a concern around anyone approaching them with information regarding their data, whether that be a patient or indeed a member of staff, to contact the police immediately using 101. In terms of Colin Smith's earlier point around patient services, I am pleased to say that at the moment there has been a minimal impact to patient services. However, I think it's important to note that we know at this stage that the incident has resulted in the need for some staff to change working practices in the short term, and I'm very grateful to everyone who is working to ensure people still receive the best possible care while we work at pace to ensure a return to normal working practices. The difficulty, and again, I'm limited in what I can say because of the live police investigation, is around how we can directly contact patients, given that we do not know exactly what data has been taken, other than the scale of the data and what it's going to be used for. But the likelihood is, as Dumfries and Galloway have suggested, that it might include patient and staff information.
Colin Smith.
Cyber attacks on the NHS are obviously not new, but it's clear from this attack they are becoming more common and more sophisticated. And of course, they're not unique to NHS Dumfries and Galloway. Now, given that the security used by Dumfries and Galloway Health Board will have been very similar to that used by the NHS across Scotland, in light of these attacks, which have led to a breach of confidential data, will there now be a review of cyber security protections used by the NHS across Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
So obviously a breach of confidential data is an extremely serious matter, which is why there is a multi-agency response to this. I am confident in what I have been advised from Dumfries and Galloway in terms of their preparedness for this, and I'm happy to share in a more private way some of that confidence with Colin Smith or indeed any other colleagues around this. In terms of their preparedness for such a cyber attack. The attack also demonstrates the clear need for continued investment in the cyber capability of our public sector, not just here in Scotland but across the UK. We've seen most recently the attack that happened, very similar circumstances, on the University of Manchester and NHS England. So Colin Smith is right to point to this being a pattern that we need to be alive to, and the Scottish Government and NHS boards have continued to make investment in the development of the Cyber Security Centre of Excellence in recent years, and that centre has been delivered organically. It's already the focal point of cyber defence, and this incident response allows for that to be done on a national scale. But of course, to return to Colin Smith's question, we will continue to monitor and keep under review the implications of this upon ensuring that our cyber resilience continues to be as strong as possible.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In a similar vein to Colin Smith's question, I know that the NHS Board are working with the National Crime Agency, the UK National Cyber Security Centre, the Scottish Government and with the Information Commissioner to mitigate and investigate the recent cyber attack. It was clear that at yesterday's NHS briefing that the Board were not able to provide full information as advised by the professional agencies. But one thing is clear is that cyber attacks are going to become more commonplace. So can the Cabinet Secretary provide further information on how lessons learned from NHS D&G event, including business continuity plan, for example, how will that be shared with other public bodies in Scotland to ensure they are prepared to prevent, as far as possible, a similar attack in the future?
Cabinet Secretary.
I thank Emma Harper for that question. I'm glad that she and other colleagues, both here at the Scottish Parliament and also at Westminster, I hope found the briefing from Dumfries and Galloway yesterday helpful, although caveated as I've had to be by the fact that this is a live police investigation. I want to assure Emma Harper that my officials have already started a lessons identified exercise, the learning from which will be shared at a suitable time. I also want to be clear that as detail about the incident becomes available, I will continue to share as much information as we can with other public bodies. This will be through the multi-agency arrangements that she mentions in her question, in order for public bodies that they can that they're able to take preventative steps to defend against similar attacks in future.
Finlay Carson.
Presiding officer, there are real concerns being raised by my constituents about how the leaked personal and sensitive data may be used, and therefore information, guidance and support from Dumfries and Galloway Health Board will be absolutely crucial in the coming days and weeks. Can the Cabinet Secretary give details on what assistance the Scottish Government is giving to NHS Dumfries and Galloway to make sure patients and staff are aware of the potential risks and the actions they may need to take to protect themselves, and confirm if he believes that NHS Dumfries and Galloway have abided by data protection legislation in a manner and the timing in which they've informed patients and staff of these risks?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, President Officer. I thank again Finlay Carson for his question, the way he has approached it, and similar to the offer I've made to Colin Smith and Emma Harper, I'd be happy to write to Finlay Carson around some of the steps that were taken in a preventative way by Dumfries and Galloway to try to avoid this happening in the first place, and indeed the steps that they've taken since. He is absolutely right, and I reiterate, the breach of confidential data is an extremely important and serious matter, and I'll be happy to set out to Finlay Carson the steps that were taken in order to provide public information at the earliest possible opportunity to ensure that people were able to protect themselves against any misuse of the data that has been gathered. I want to reiterate NHS Dumfries and Galloway's call for the staff and public to be on their guard for any attempt to access their systems or approaches from anyone claiming to be in possession of data relating to them. If anyone finds themselves in this situation, they should contact Police Scotland immediately by calling 101.
Question number two, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the cost and impact of the transfer of HMP Kilmarnock into public ownership.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, HMP Kilmarnock successfully transferred to Scottish Prison Service ownership and management on Sunday, the 17th of March. SPS and the private operator delivered a smooth transition that supported staff and those in custody, whilst maintaining the high standards already set within the prison. SPS will continue to deliver quality services at the prison while benefiting from the skills and experience of the existing staff group there. It has been Scottish Government policy since 2007 that prisons should be owned and managed by the public sector, and public safety, rehabilitation and well-being should not be driven by private profit. Final overall costs of operations at HMP Kilmarnock will depend on a variety of factors, but are currently estimated at £11.6 million for 2024-25.
Sharon Dowie.
Thank you for that answer. Recently, His Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons raised serious concerns about some of the prisons already in the estate. She said that HMP Greenock needs bulldozed, HMP Berlinney is close to catastrophic failure. Meanwhile, HMP Berlinney's replacement is already overdue and over budget, as is the project for HMP Highland. It's evident that the service is already struggling with significant financial constraints, whilst under private control, HMP Kilmarnock was praised for its successful performance. A recently released report also raised a number of concerns about the transition. So can the Cabinet Secretary assure us that plans have been put in place to ensure that this prison will not fall into the same level of disrepute as the others?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would be the last person to demur from the challenges that exist across the current prison estate, not helped, of course, by a very high prison population. Of course, I would not necessarily accept the member's characterisation of the current estate. There are, of course, well-established plans in place to replace HMP Berlinney with HMP Glasgow. Similarly, with HMP Highland. I have answered a number of questions, both orally and in written, in terms of Greenock, Highland and Glasgow, and most recently made a statement in and around the pressures on the entire estate. But the member should be aware of the good performance of public sector prisons in Scotland in comparison to private sector prisons, particularly in and around violence and drug incidents, which again I have quoted in chamber. And she will also be aware that there are two stages. Stage one is the successful transition that we have seen, and also the actions that will take place over the next year.
Sharon Dowie.
That I should just point out, it wasn't my characterisation of the prison service, it was actually His Majesty's Chief Inspector of Prisons. The Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service has said that they're committed to ensuring the transition of HMP Kilmarnock into public ownership will maintain the high standards that the prison displays. However, through the transfer, staff have lost the security of 56 body-worn cameras. They have to recruit a further 70 staff. And there's also a question over whether 4 drug detection dogs, which have proved to be an important asset intercepting drugs worth around £1.2 million from entering HMP Kilmarnock, will be maintained. Can the Cabinet Secretary confirm that the existing level of safety and security will be maintained at HMP Kilmarnock despite the loss of these cameras? Can she provide us with an update on the drug detection dogs? And can she also confirm that there will be no further overcrowding until all staff are recruited?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, it is important to acknowledge that even with the transition arrangements, the transitional operating model, that staff in HMP Kilmarnock will increase. And that is so that staff who are working long shifts or back shifts on a weekend can actually have a break. And I think that is a good example of why having prisons operate for the public interest as opposed to the private profiteering that exists across these islands in terms of private prisons. Presiding Officer, in terms of body-worn cameras, it's important for Parliament to be aware that the current body-worn cameras in HMP Kilmarnock were not part of the contract. There is no agreement for these pieces of equipment to transfer, but it is also worth recognising that there will be a pilot operation that will commence in April. It will take place in 3 prisons in the estate, and thereafter body-worn cameras will be rolled out across the prison estate. In terms of the dog detection dogs and handlers, I have already corresponded with members on that. The 2 detection dogs and handlers have now transferred into SPS following transition, and they do indeed play a critical role in tackling the drug crisis.
Willie Coffey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The proposal to bring Kilmarnock Prison into the public sector has been there for 17 years now, so I wonder where the Tories have been hiding this issue until now. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this Government has a great record and commitment to delivering more and better public services, unlike the Tories, who would sell off everything and anything to bail themselves out of the financial mess they've created themselves?
In relation to the substantive question, Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, and the member is right to point to the historical position of this government. Indeed, our manifesto in 2007 said we are committed to a publicly owned and run service, and that is because our assessment is that public services, whether it be hospitals or prisons, should be run for public good and not private profit. Private prisons is a legacy of previous administrations, whether it's the Liberal Labour coalition or indeed the Conservative government pre-devolution.
Katie Clark.
Could the Cabinet Secretary explain why the trade union community has been derecognised at Kilmarnock Prison? Is she concerned that community advise that the Scottish Prison Service is refusing to meet with them, and as a result, they are now issuing an indicative ballot for industrial action? Will the Cabinet Secretary intervene to ensure that this dispute is resolved?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am indeed about to reply to correspondence that I've received from Ms Clark and indeed Ms McNeill on these issues. In terms of the union recognition, the Scottish Prison Service throughout the consultation process, which was intensive, indicated its intention to maintaining its existing trade union arrangements that it currently exists for all public sector prisons in Scotland, and the transferring staff group will be covered by those existing arrangements. Again, it's important to point out to Parliament that the arrangement that exists between Serco and Community Union was a voluntary agreement, not a legally binding one, and therefore it is my view does not place an obligation on SPS, who have worked hard to maintain their current relationships that they have with trade unions, namely, but not exclusively, the POA.
Thank you. That concludes topical questions.